Do you know what time is it?
Hey guys, it's me Critical Cubing, and today we are going to see what we can learn from Matt's Vilux 5.13 ERSol, and this is the same scramble as the one that Matt's got. Matt's is a dual curl neutral solver, so he either solves the blue cross or the green cross. And in this scramble, he actually did the blue cross, so let's check it out. So for the blue cross, the cross pieces are there, and there. And the white is actually in the correct place, and this orange and yellow are also in good places in relation to each other. So once you insert this orange, the yellow piece will actually come in here, and you can insert the yellow piece in one single move, and then at the end you can insert this red with one move or three moves depending on how you solve your cross. So what Mats did here was that he moved this white piece aside with the D move so as to get the orange and white in relation to each other, and then he can insert this orange down with two moves, and doing this D move actually moves this red piece also. So once you are done inserting this orange piece, the yellow comes in here like I had mentioned before, but once you insert this yellow piece, the red piece is also set up nicely and you can insert this with one single move like that. So the cross solution was very efficient. There are other ways you can actually do the cross, but this was probably the most efficient solution. What I would have done from here would be just do a U and then insert the cross like that, but that is of course probably not as efficient as what Matt's did. The cross solution was pretty efficient. The first F drill was also pretty easy to track in this one. It would be these two, because once you do the D move, right, this corner would actually be placed at the back, and the only time you are using R moves in your cross solution is when you are inserting the last red piece, and at that point you are doing R prime. So doing an R prime would put this corner at the top with the blue facing towards the side like that, and the edge was in here. So once you do the D move, the edge will be placed at the bottom. So once you insert the orange, the edge will come to the top, and your first pair will be in there and there with the whites facing on the top. Pretty easy first pair also, and very efficient first pair also, because pairing these two F-drill pairs is also very easy. So let us do the cross. D, insert, yellow, red. So once you're done with the cross, the next step is to orient the cross so that all of the pieces come together like this, and this can be done either two ways, with a D move or doing a U move like that. Now generally people just use the D move because that is the one that is commonly used. I entirely forget that you can also make the pieces come together using a U move. Now the advantage of using U move over D move is that U moves actually do a rotation for you. So from this angle, when you have these two as your first pair, if you do a D move, then you have to do a rotation after that to pair these two up. Otherwise, from this angle, if you do a UW prime, then the cube does the rotation for you, so you can actually start and do your F12 pair like that. So in this case, doing a UW prime was a really wise move by Matt, because it actually does not break the flow of the cross to F-drill transition, whereas doing a D move actually breaks the flow because you have to do a rotation in here and then start doing this F-drill pair. Whereas when doing a D move, you don't have to do a rotation and you actually keep the flow in the solve. So from here, for making the cross come together, Matt did a UW prime move so as to do the rotation for him so that he can directly go on into F2L without doing an extra unnecessary rotation. So from here, Matt did a U and solve this pair, which is quite easy. You hide the corner, make the edge come to this place. So when you get the corner back up, these two are formed. And then you can just insert that. Now once you're done with that F12 pair, there are quite a lot of options that he could have done. There was this pair, which generally I think people might have done, and then there was this pair, which was also pretty easy to do. However, there was also this pair, which was the most efficient. So from here, Matt solved these two pairs, which is very efficient and a very wise decision from him. So he did a rotation like this, took this edge out and set up this three move insert, F12 insert, and solve like that at the back. Now only two pairs are left, and you actually cannot really do this pair because the corner is stuck at the back and the edge is stuck in here. So the only viable option left for him was solving that. And there are also a couple of ways you can solve this F12 pair. The most common way of solving this F12 pair is by doing something like that. So you set up, so you put the F12 pair in here, and then you do RU prime R prime U, RU prime R prime to pair that up, which isn't too bad. But a more efficient way of solving this pair would be doing an R prime U2 and then inserting that and then inserting this. But this algorithm is generally used when you have this pair as your last slot, and you can just do this, this and this and be done with that. But in this case, you cannot actually use this algorithm. So you have to try and do something else. There's another way also that you can actually solve this case, and this is probably what I might have done. So you do R, so this is an RUD F12 case. So you do R prime D prime, RU do R prime DR, which actually gives you a nice T-move insert like this. And then you can insert it at the back. And the last step would be to do your intuitive F12 for this, which is what Max did. Once he inserted this F12 pair, he got this F12 pair in here. So doing intuitive F12 was the wise decision in here, because that will keep the flow of the solve and not really break it. So from here, so generally in intuitive F12, you're asked to hide the corner and then get the edge to the correct place so you can set up your F12 pairs, and which is exactly what Max did. He did an RU prime R prime to hide the corner, did a U prime to set up this F12 pair. Then you can just do an RU R prime to set up your insert, and then you can just insert it at the back. Doing so, this corner gets popped to the U layer, and you have this easy 3-move insert, which you can do like that. Now, the OLL is a step which makes this solve a 5-second solve and not a 7-second solve. So this OLL is similar to the one that Lucas Etter got for his world record solve, but this OLL is just a mirror case. So if you remember my Lucas Etter video, you had to solve the OLL with R moves, but in this case, you do the same algorithm but just with the L move. When you have this OLL like this, these two huge blocks and these two are opposite, then you are quite certain that you will actually get a PLL skip after you have solved the OLL. So you would solve this OLL like that, and because you were anticipating a PLL skip, while you're doing your last move, you can see that you have two sides fully solved, and this only happens when you have a PLL skip. Now that you are certain that you have a PLL skip, you can just do a U prime and your solve is pretty much done.
So what can we learn from Max Valk? First, when creating crosses, you should spend a little bit more time and try to find the most efficient solution instead of the solution that just pops out in your head the first time. Next, for F12, this solve just proves that sticking to the basics will of course fetch you good times. And when we see solves from Lucas Etter, Felix Zemdegs, and even Max Valk, they all have used intuitive F12 for most of their solves. So instead of learning lots and lots of F12 algorithms, you should be trying to find out your own intuitive algorithms for your F12 cases. And then if you think that your intuitive F12 algorithm is very inefficient, then you can look into some algorithms for that. Also, while doing F12, choose pairs wisely. Instead of solving the first pair that you see or the pair that you are tracking, you should look at all of your available options and then choose the one which will be the most wise and the most efficient to solve. And the main thing that I could see from his solve was his look ahead. While solving, he did not even pause for a single second. I'm pretty sure most of you guys can turn at 10 TPS per second, but just because your hands are capable of turning at 10 TPS per second does not mean that your brain can process 10 TPS per second. So you should only turn as fast as your brain can process. And then lastly, for last layer, you should be learning some subsets like OLLCP, COLL, winter variation, ZBLL, VLS. So learning subsets for last layer will help you fetch good times. So that's pretty much it from this video, guys. Watch my other What Can We Learn videos like the Felix Zemdegs and Lucas Etter edition. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time. Take care, guys, and bye.